us, O God, creator and ruler of all things, and that we may feel the working of your mercy, grant that we may serve you with all our heart. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
I am all alone.
Indeed, someone might say, you have faith and I have works. Demonstrate your faith to me without works, and I will demonstrate my faith to you from my works.
Are inadequate to who Jesus is. And so Peter speaks, and he says, you are the Christ. What he would have said in his native Aramaic was, you are the Mashiach, which, from which our word Messiah comes from. Christ and Messiah are the same word in two different languages, and both mean anointed one. The Messiah was the figure that Jews had been waiting for centuries, the new King David, the definitive bearer of God's salvation for the Jews, the powerful military leader who would vanquish all of Israel's enemies and create a new era of world dominance, of economic prosperity, of peace. Now, kings and prophets are anointed with oil to begin their role as a king or a prophet. So this awaiting figure was referred to as the Christ in Greek, or the Mashiach in Hebrew, or the Anointed One in English. Now notice that Jesus does not correct them. He accepts this lofty title that Peter places on him. If Jesus would have said that he was a new prophet, or Elijah coming down from heaven, that would have been saying, of course, an enormous amount. But to accept the title of Messiah was beyond the beyond. The disciples now knew that they were in the intimate company of the One. They were the most privileged men in Israelite history because of that. But you know, you and I are the modern-day disciples of Jesus. We've taken the place now of those who have long died 2,000 years ago. Therefore, we stand next to the figure of Christ, just as the disciples did in this account today. And we do so as intimate friends of Him, especially when we receive Him at Eucharist. Therefore, we are privileged beyond our ability to comprehend. But then in the account comes this reversal, because Jesus clarifies what his messiahship is going to look like. He will be rejected, he will be killed, but then he will rise again. Now this is a pattern that Jesus has mentioned a number of times throughout the Gospels, both in relation to himself and to those who would follow him. For instance, one of the times he does that is later on in this very same passage, when he says, those who wish to follow me must take up the cross daily, deny themselves, and then follow me. In other words, the way of God is always the way of suffering love. The way to fullness of life passes through the path of suffering. I realize that the word ego has a specific definition within the psychological world. But in the spiritual world, we use that word more of a way of talking about the place inside us, the ego, the place inside us from which flows our propensity to sin. And because of that, it's kind of a selfish place that's turned in on the self. That's what we call an ego in the spiritual life. Our ego wants glory and a path of least resistance. And I think if most of us are honest with ourselves, we've encountered that place. We've experienced that place in our own life. The ego wants wealth and privilege and pleasure, and it wants those who threaten those goods to be eliminated, to get out. This is why we hear Peter rebuke Jesus for his word that described the Messiah. I mean, nothing in Jesus' description says anything about glory, prosperity, vanquishing enemies, military victories, nothing of the sort. And those are the things that most of the people of his time expected the Messiah to bring. Even though, as the first reading from Isaiah, not what it's about. Prophecy shows that there are other ways of thinking about what the Messiah would be like. But the people chose to ignore those passages in favor of what attracted their egos. But Jesus says today, the true path is always one of ego diminishment. It always involves letting go of the demands of the ego, so as to surrender now to the direction of the Holy Spirit that stretches infinitely beyond the imagination of the small, self-centered ego. But this is going to hurt. The ego has to be put to death in a certain sense if it is to find its richer self. So Jesus says in the gospel today, if you want to find your life, you must lose your life. That's what he's referring to, this part of us called the ego. Get rid of it. The ego has to walk that dark path of self-denial if it is to come to a deeper life. Now Jesus said that he would be rejected and killed by the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. You know, once a human being has started to leave the path of the ego, the path of accumulation, of self-aggrandizing, we become, in a certain sense, free, then to be used as instruments by God to be a transformational element of the egotism that exists around us. Precisely through our love, through our willingness to bear the aggression of those who don't see things this way, with patience and compassion. Jesus now is going to go into the city where he is opposed. He is going right into the heart of the place where he is, and he knows it. To do what? To destroy them? No. To transform their aggression, and to have the whole world by his compassion, to in essence swallow it all up into the divine person. Once we have found freedom in this area, we've learned to walk that dark path. Now we can help others find that same path. So Jesus is not about the business of destroying the scribes and the Pharisees. He wants to change them and all people by the power of his own life. After Jesus clarifies what the Messiah has come to do, Peter goes from being his best to being his worst. And at his best, the Father has revealed to him the fact that Jesus is the Messiah. Peter could not have figured that out by himself. The Lord, God, revealed it to him. And that's Jesus took it as a sign to say, this is now the one. This is the one who will lead my church, the prototype of the Pope. And so upon this rock I will build my church. But then Peter goes from that, after he hears what the Messiahship is all about, he then goes to his worst, because he speaks openly to rebuke the Lord. We have to recognize that all of us, through our sinful tendency, will go to the same place as Peter is left to our own devices. Peter saw, I'm sure, Jesus' Messiahship as just one more opportunity for Peter's ego. You know, I'm with the one. I'm now the prime minister of the one. That's going to mean attention, power, privilege, honor. Maybe even a little money down the road. So Peter tries to reject what Jesus has said. And when you and I walk the path of the ego, we also reject the path that Jesus lays out before us. We think not like God, but as simple human beings do. So Jesus invites us into a whole new way of thinking, into a new mind. That word conversion in Greek, metanoia, Christian now is led to see the path of life as containing negation, self-denial, suffering love, bearing the burden of the other willingly. That's the path to life, says Jesus. And as he also tells us today, he is the path to resurrection. My final thought, today's gospel is the pattern of what happens to us at every Mass. We come together. We gather in intimacy with the One. We know who He is, the Holy One of God, and we confess Him as such. But then we witness the re-presentation of His saving death. That's what the Eucharist is. It brings us into the presence of the saving action of Christ, making present again the cross and the death of Jesus, the way, the path of the One, and which we must follow in thanksgiving as He transforms us. Let's stand up together. I believe in one God, Father, Maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God of God, light of light, begotten of begotten. Graciously hear our prayers in the same Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you. Fruit of the earth and the work of human hands, the Lord will come forth the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink. Pray for us, sisters, that my sacrifice of yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty God.
May the Lord accept sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all souls, Church.
Look with favor on our supplications, O Lord, and in your kindness accept these, your servants' offerings, that what each has offered to the honor of your name may serve the salvation of all, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Give thanks to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For we know it belongs to your boundless glory that you came to redeem mortal beings with your divinity, and even fashioned for us a remedy to our mortality itself, that the cause of our downfall might become the means of our salvation, through Christ our Lord. Through him the host of angels adores your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we approach. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my house. kingdom of his heavenly gift, the Lord, we pray, take possession of our minds and bodies, so that his effects, and not our own desires, may always prevail in us through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If you have not already registered for the religious education, now is the time to do so. Please see Carol McDevitt in the foyer at the Mass. Classes begin Sunday, the 27th of September at 11 a.m. Carol asks that the parents come into the church when you drop off the children for a brief meeting. Meanwhile, the children should come up to the piano to begin learning some carols for our Christmas program. Join us for our last barbecue of the season, directly outside. All are welcome, parishioner or not. The church provides the meat and drinks, and the potlucks are too good to miss. I will not be in Buena Vista this week. I will be on retreat with the rest of the priests of the diocese and the bishop. This is our yearly mandatory retreat. So I will return on Friday.